is. We are few but mighty, right? That's it, right on the nail of me thinking about the incredible rise in COVID cases. I was very reluctant to think about going and doing anything out in the community, and actually I've decided now I'm not even going to do the procession for the All Souls procession, because it's just too much. So those of you who kind of keep tabs on this, we have about 4 new cases in the congregation since last Sunday. So we want to be attentive to where you are, sitting social distancing, wearing a mask if you think that you need one, and being very attentive to that. It is the Feast of All Saints, and all of you saints are being celebrated today. So we will be celebrating the Feast of the Living and those who have gone before us all together. So our music is going to be a little bit celebratory and a little altered also because some of our choir members have COVID. So we'll be celebrating that. Update on Deacon Jefferson, for those of you who've been asking how he's doing. He is doing well. He didn't end up going in and coming home on the same day. He did end up staying in the hospital overnight, but I think all things are good, and I'm trying to encourage him not to be working, right? Stay home, do what he's supposed to be doing so that when he comes back, that knee's in really good shape. And then I also want to remind us that on the calendar for next week, and Yvonne, are we doing this on the patio? Is that what I understand?
That's what we've advertised.
Okay, so you'll notice in Acts that next Sunday after church, Yvonne and her co-author are going to be doing a book reading and book discussion on her book. The material on the table as you go out is there about the book. If you didn't already read it, it's excellent. I would encourage you. It will be outside on the patio, and I think that that's safe. And I believe that Yvonne is hoping that those of you who are planning to come and stay for the reading will also talk to her about doing some refreshments so that the folks who come from the community, because it's been widely advertised, maybe could have some snacks and some things. But I'm really glad. I hope the weather's good, that we are going to be doing it outside. That'll be good. Okay. I think that's the only announcements that I have. Oh, we do have Bishop's Committee this week, so that you all know, keep us in your prayers as we continue to move towards getting ourselves prepared for our budget for 2023 and all of the things that are necessary leading up to that. So let's take a deep breath. And find yourself in your space, in this space. And allow ourselves to be aware of the Feast of the All Saints. And all the saints sitting amongst us. And those saints who have gone before us. As we gather together in worship of our God.
Thank you.
My heart is just going like this. We are on page 355, or 277 in the Spanish language prayer book. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son, Christ our Lord. Give us grace to follow your blessed saints in all virtuous and godly living, that we may come to those ineffable joys that you have prepared for those who truly love you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, in joy everlasting. Dios Todopoderoso, tú has entregado a tus eligios y una sola comunión de hermandad y en el cuerpo místico de Hijo Cristo, nuestro Señor. Danos gracia para que de tal modo seguimos tu benditos santos en todo virtuoso y santa vida, que aclaremos los gozos inefables de tu, que tú has preparada para los que te aman sinceramente por Jesucristo nuestro Señor, que contigo en el Espíritu Santo vive y reine un solo Dios, en gloria sempiterna. Amén.
Daniel, chapter 7, beginning at the first verse. In the first year of King Belshazzar of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and a vision of his head as he lay in bed. Then he wrote the dream down. I, Daniel, saw in my vision by night the four winds of heaven stirring up the great sea. And four great beasts came up out of the sea, different from one another. As for me, Daniel, my spirit was troubled within me, and the visions of my head terrified me. I approached one of the attendants to ask him the truth concerning all of this. So he said that he would disclose to me the interpretation of the matter. As for these four great beasts, four kings shall arise out of the earth. But the holy ones of the Most High shall receive the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, forever and ever. The word of the Lord.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Ephesians. In Christ, we have also obtained an inheritance, having been destined according to the purpose of him who accomplishes all things, according to his counsel and will, so that we, who were the first to set our hope on Christ, might live for the praise of his glory. In him, you also, when you have heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and had believed in him, were marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. This is the pledge of our inheritance toward redemption as God's own people, to the praise of his glory. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints. And for this reason, I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you. What are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints? And what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe, according to the working of his great power? God put this power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet and has made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus looked up at his disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, and when they exclude you, revile you, and defame you on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in heaven, for that is what their ancestors did to the prophets. But woe to those of you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who are laughing now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all speak well of you, for that is what their ancestors did to the false prophets. But I say to you that listen, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who abuse you. If anyone strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from anyone who takes away your coat, do not withhold even your shirt. Give to everyone who begs from you, and if anyone takes away your goods, do not ask for them again. Do to others as you would have them do to you." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the presence of all the saints of God, amen. So what's this sermon called? What's this reading called? The Beatitudes, right? It's often also referred to as a Sermon on the Mount. Every time I read this, and maybe you could tell, I remember standing on that place in the Holy Land. Standing on that spot where they say that Jesus preached this particular sermon. The way that the sermon reads, sometimes you might envision that it is some kind of a big mountain, right? It's like a little hill. And on that hillside, you can see how people would have gathered around so that Jesus could look out and see the entire crowd that was gathered there around him. That space is so important if we think of it as a sacred space and a place also that we might want to consider and try and understand why Jesus would have preached this sermon and to whom. I wonder if this reading is sometimes heard, though, as a recipe for being a saint, especially since we're reading it on the Feast of All Saints. It does provide a guidepost for us, but does it provide a guide to being a saint? I tend to ask myself what might not be so obvious about the readings. And what comes to mind are the words of the great theologian, Mr. Rogers. Even people who are good most of the time are bad some of the time. And people who are bad most of the time are good some of the time. If we take those words literally, I think our minds go directly to judging who's good and who's bad, who's in and who's out. And the problem with that kind of thought can really get us into trouble, and really, I don't think it really helps our hearts or our souls much to be sitting in judgment. A few weeks ago, our guest preacher, Shaniqua, actually warned us about reading scripture in this way, othering people. And so you might imagine that even this one could be a slippery slope. But have you ever thought a bad thought about someone? Be honest. I think that we can all say that we have, right? And if we think for a moment about one of those times when you were thinking something, maybe even just this morning, bad about someone, think about how it made you feel to think that way. I think we can probably all agree that when you think of it that way, we know it's not our best moment, and it's not a feeling that we want to do. So if we follow the train of thought from Mr. Rogers, maybe we hear this reading in a broader perspective, one that is forgiving, stemming from compassion and from charity. So let's go back now and think about who was gathered around Jesus on that hillside that day. The people who seemed to be drawn to Jesus were people who heard about him and heard that he often seemed to be speaking to the people who were experiencing hardships, who were being marginalized, who were being persecuted, and who were being rejected. Maybe that group of people came to hear them because they felt that he was talking to them, that he knew and understood how they felt. Have you ever had that feeling? When someone made you feel rejected or hurt or something, that someone was there to listen, or to even tell you that they understood, or that they'd been in your shoes before. That's a great feeling, isn't it? I think Jesus knew who was there. Maybe not every single individual, and maybe not even by name, but he knew who was being touched by his teachings. And I think they were very much who he wanted to reach to anyway. The first thing that Jesus tells them is that they are his people, his family, and blessed. Not only because they are his family, but because they suffer. He recognizes that they share a common struggle, and that sticking together makes them part of a family, a community where others understand and can belong to. He lets them know that they are not alone. Isn't that like the feeling that we've had when someone tells us that they understand how we feel? So what happens when we feel like we are understood or heard? Aren't we drawn to the person who is listening to us? Don't we find ourselves connecting? It's very good news, just like it probably was for those people on the hillside, to know that Jesus heard them, saw them, understood them. I have to ask myself if I've ever felt that. If I've ever felt unloved or invisible at any point in my life. And I ask you to think about that too, even though I would wish for you that the answer would be no, that you hadn't felt that way. But I know how tender our hearts are, and that sometimes people do and say things that hurt us even if they didn't mean to. I can't help but also remember back to last Sunday's reading and Zacchaeus. He wanted so desperately to see Jesus. He wanted to see Jesus because he also wanted to be recognized for all the good that he had and what he was doing, right? But all it took was Jesus connecting with him at the heart level, and he was transformed. So I wonder, when we think about this reading, if we're thinking about it as a recipe to being a good Christian. So we can ask ourselves, are we humble? Do we work for peace? Do we love our enemies? Do we give to the needy? Do we fast and pray? Do we serve more than one master? Do we judge? I think it's important for us to ask ourselves examining questions. We often include a confession, in fact, in our worship services, certainly in the daily offices and in the Eucharistic services, because we have to ask ourselves if we are living out the way that we are called to live as Christians. The confession says, in thought, word, and deed. And I think if we're totally honest with ourselves, we can say that we don't always think kindly, speak gently, or act lovingly to others. Certainly, we have to begin with ourselves anytime we think of the readings or the teachings of Jesus. And it's important for us to do that. But it's equally important for us to ask ourselves the questions about our faith in community. We don't have a faithful life in a vacuum. And most of us don't live in a cave. So then we can ask ourselves not only the individual questions that examine who we are and how we are living, but we can also ask it in a corporate life. How is St. Andrew's representing the spirit of Jesus' teachings? How is the Diocese of Arizona representing the teachings? Or even the Episcopal Church, or broader beyond that, the Christian community? Or even, we could say, our neighborhoods, Tucson, Pima County, the state of Arizona, and the United States. As we celebrate the Feast of All Saints, we do remember all of our ancestors, those who have gone before us. And I'm grateful to all of those who have helped come and build that remembrance in the ofrenda that we built for Dia de los Muertos, that we wanted to open our lives and our ways in community, to be in commemoration with others who might be missing someone. We say in one of our prayers, in the prayers at a celebration of life at a funeral, those we see no longer. Because we know that their spirit remains alive and well in us and in the world around us. It's a powerful sign to remember all of those who have gone before us. But it's also a temptation. And that's where those things like jokes that we make about, but we've always done it that way, get in the way of our commemorating. Because I don't think any of our ancestors taught us, said anything to us, or modeled for us that we should stay stuck in a certain way. I think they also were inviting us to think about the newness in their own lives. I think about my mom. Now she's 100 years old. And if you can imagine, go back 100 years to 1922, what was life like then? And what has she seen in her lifetime? What can she teach me and those around us by listening to her? This also brings us into that space where we realize that our elders should be honored and respected and brought into the conversations for what we can learn from them. And at the same time, those with younger ears and younger life can learn things, but also teach our elders right? And it becomes a two-way in thought, word, and deed. Tucson is one of those wonderful places that celebrates diversity and cultures. We celebrate the diversity of cultures that existed here long before settlers came. Things like the All Souls procession or the procession of angels yesterday. All of the different kinds of holidays. But this week, even the church recognizes in the commemoration of the dead in All Souls, and today in the celebration of All Saints. They're both celebrations of the spirits of people who have been important to us. You may not participate in any of those traditions, but we can call upon those important people in our lives, individually and corporately, and know that they influenced our lives, whoever they may be. And we commend them today. So as we imagine and celebrate the ancestors who have gone before us, we can go all the way back to Jesus' time and imagine ourselves sitting on that hillside. Imagine ourselves having Jesus listen to us and call us by name, because the way that Jesus identified what our suffering was made us realize that Jesus knew the sacrifices that we had made and how we were living our life. So let's remember that we're still working, just like they were then, on their thoughts, words, and deeds. And ask yourself this question. If we heard that Jesus was coming through Tucson this afternoon, and there was going to be a gathering on the side of a mountain, who would be coming to hear him? Who would fill that mountainside? Will it still be those who feel rejected, disrespected, marginalized in any way? Those who feel poor? Would you be among them? And if there were people coming to hear Jesus and what he said so long ago because they wanted to know that he knew what they were saying and they were feeling, that he was hearing their pain, feeling their sadness. The question for me is, if there are going to be people gathered on the side of a mountain, it means we still have work to do, because that means that we aren't doing the work that Jesus called us to do. If we were, there would be no people needing to sit on the side of that mountain to hear words of comfort, to be understood, because they'd know that we hear them. They'd know that we see them. They'd be honored each and every day, in our thoughts, in our words, and in our actions. Blessed are they who come to hear the word of the Lord, for they will learn a new way. Amen. We're on page 358. I ask you to join me in reciting the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit. He became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and he was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Together with all the saints, we pray for those who have gone before us, especially today, those whose names are in our hearts and on our altars. Rashelia Engelston, Catherine Betters, Leroy Betters, Ernstine Betters, Nellie Ruth Burke, Ronald Burke, Chris Barcamote, Nellie and Sam Bruce, Charlie Brookhart, Jerima Butler, Herbert and Beverly Chulock, Malcolm Chun, Clifford N. Click, Christopher Compton, Chester and Clara Cogden, Dorothy and Edward Cogden, Stephen and Persis Cogden, Esther Cormode, Roy Cormode, Kat and Ambrose D'Arpino, Lillian Francis Dixon, Ginny Doctor, Peter Durer, Cliff Ed Miller, Mary Focker, Dwayne Freelix, Alexander John Gary, Alfina Marie Gary, Bryant Harris, Maria Hoops, Eileen Wood Kilpatrick, F. Michael Kirkpatrick, John Kraft, Jean Kraft, David Leach, Bill Leach, Paul and Sarah Leach, Christopher Eric Lindquist, Halcyon Delight Moggin, Judy McAdoo, Gordon K. McBride, Thomas Meixner, Chet Marocca, Frank and Leslie Morris, John Ross Muntian, Esther Park, Jonathan Glue Penn, Jonathan Stephen Penn, Stephen Frank Penn, Donna Petty, Clint Petty, Alda Powell, Sherry and Ted Robinson, Norman Royals, Stanley Keith Rudisil, Richard Sains, Josephine Shoemaker, Steve Schwartz, Nicholas Short, John Short, Margaret Snyder, Gloria Tillis, Bella and Miles Wetzel, John and Rebecca Wetzel, Ella Willen, Lynn and Marion Willen, Ellen, Alan, Calvin, Jeremy, Juanita, Laura, and two lost infants. For the souls of our families, we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. For the souls of our friends, we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. For the souls of our wrongdoers, we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. For the souls of the just, we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. For those who have no one to pray for them, we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. Christ, remember the good they have done, Lord, hear our prayer. Christ, receive them into eternal life, Lord, hear our prayer. Christ, comfort all those who mourn, Lord, hear our prayer. Lord our God, the death of our brothers and sisters recalls our human condition and the brevity of our lives on earth. But for those who believe in your love, death is not the end, nor does it destroy the bonds you forge in our lives. We share the faith of your Son's disciples and the hope of the children of God. Bring the light of Christ's resurrection on this time of testing and pain as we pray for all those who have died and for those who love them. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
On page 360, let us now confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you and forgive you all of your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. And now, my sisters and brothers, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be always with you. Make good your vows to the Most High. No vas a usar este. No, no quieres usar este. No, el otro. Ok. Ándale pues. Aquí en el medio donde andas, ¿sí? ¿Eh? ¿Está bien así? Ah, bueno. Ok. ¿Estamos listos? Ok. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For in the multitude of your saints, you have surrounded us with a great cloud of witnesses, that we might rejoice in their fellowship and run with endurance the race that is set before us, and together with them receive the crown of glory that never fades away. Porque en el multitud de tus santos nos has rodeado en una gran nube de testigos para que nos recogemos en tu comunión y corramos con perseverancia la carrera que nos les propuesta. Y junto con ellos recibimos la corona de gloria que no se marche. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we'd fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and the Father of all. Padre Santo y Bondadoso, en tu amor infinito nos hiciste para ti, y cuando caímos en pecado y quedamos esclavados del mal y en la muerte, tú en tu misericordia enviaste a Jesucristo, tu Hijo único y eterno, para compartir nuestra naturaleza humana, para vivir y morir como un de nosotros, y así reconciliamos contigo, el Dios y el Padre de todos. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and he offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. When he had given thanks to you, he broke it and he gave it to them and he said, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. When he had given thanks to them, he said, "Drink this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension. We offer to you these gifts. Padre, en este sacrificio de alabanza y acción de gracias, celebramos el memorial de nuestra redención. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and the blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive the holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into the temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the power and the glory, now and forever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for all the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for us, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. This is the body. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with the spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge of and the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you every day of your life. Amen.
Amen.
now let us go out into the four sacred directions, into the east and the south, to the west and to the north, proclaiming the good news of Jesus. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia.